First, let's go to our senior White House correspondent, Pamela Braun. Pamela, we heard from the president on Air Force One just a little while ago.
That's right, Wolf, and there were some significant developments aboard Air Force One. The president breaking his silence on Stormy Daniels, claiming that he didn't know anything about the payment that his own lawyer made to Daniels just before the election. This is especially significant because now the president is on the record denying this if he ever has to give a deposition.
Before arriving back from West Virginia tonight, President Trump, for the first time, speaking publicly about porn star Stormy Daniels and the $130,000 in hush money his personal attorney paid her just before the 2016 election.
Did you know about the $130,000 payment to Stormy Daniels? Then why did Michael Cohen make it if there was no truth around the
engagement? You have to ask Michael Cohen. Michael's my attorney, and you'll have to ask Michael.
Do you know where he got the money to make that payment?
No, I don't know.
The president also voicing support for his embattled EPA administrator, Scott Pruitt.
I think that Scott has done a fantastic job. I think he's a fantastic person. I just left coal and energy country. They love Scott Pruitt.
And tonight, CNN has learned that the president has so much confidence in Pruitt, he has even considered him as a replacement for Attorney General Jeff Sessions as recently as this week. Such a move would put Pruitt in charge of the Russia investigation, giving him the authority to oversee and even fire Special Counsel Robert Mueller. But aboard Air Force One, Trump denied that he has any intention of changing Pruitt's job. Trump's support for Pruitt comes in the wake of a barrage of bad publicity. But as one source told CNN, Trump was 100% still trying to protect Pruitt because Pruitt is his fill-in for Sessions. A senior administration official tells CNN the president was not pleased with Pruitt's inability to button up several of his controversies in an interview with Fox News on Wednesday, opting to blame critics for his missteps.
Look, I do believe that as we do our work, Ed, as we're focused on these types of things, they are transformational. And anytime that you do transformational things, there are critics and there are people that come against you in that regard.
Pruitt claiming he was completely unaware two of his top aides received unapproved pay raises.
So one of your friends from Oklahoma got a pay raise that's the medium income.
They did not get a pay raise. They did not get a pay raise.
They did?
No, they did not. They did not. I stopped that yesterday.
So you stopped it.
Yeah.
Are you embarrassed that
it should
you
not
run
have happened? It should not have happened. And the officials that were involved in that process should not have done what they did.
Pruitt also struggling to explain his rental of an apartment from the wife of a prominent energy lobbyist when he first moved to Washington.
President Trump said he would drain the swamp. Draining the swamp renting an apartment from the wife of a Washington lobbyist?
I don't think that that's even remotely fair to ask that question.
Okay, so why did you then accept $50 a night to rent a condo from the wife of a Washington lawyer?
Well, let's talk about that. That is something that, again, has been reviewed by ethics officials here. They've said that it's market rate.
You're renting it from the wife of a lobbyist.
Yeah, who has no business before this agency.
Hold on a second. So who has no Mr. business? Hart is at Williams & Jensen, right? Major lobbying firm. ExxonMobil is a client.
Mr. Hart...
ExxonMobil have business before you, sir?
Mr. Hart has no clients that has business before this agency.
ExxonMobil has no
business. His firm, he's a member of a law firm. To take his relationship and extend it...
You're not answering the question.
It was like an Airbnb situation. Was there.
So you only paid for the nights you rent that you were there?
That's exactly right.
So, but that's kind of a sweetheart deal because...
No,
like,
it's not.
I've never heard of an apartment like that. I've lived in Washington over 25 years.
This was going to be my remarks. It would have taken about 2 minutes, but not that long.
Meanwhile, as President Trump chose to get out of Washington today, he was in his element in West Virginia.
Now I'm reading off the first paragraph. I said, this is boring. Come on, tell it like it is.
What was supposed to be a roundtable discussion about tax reform quickly turned into a wide-ranging campaign-like speech with the president resurrecting one of his debunked conspiracy theories.
In many places, like California, the same person votes many times. You probably heard about that. They always like to say, oh, that's a conspiracy theory. Not a conspiracy theory, folks. Millions and millions of people.
Trump going back to his first political speech and his favorite incendiary topic, illegal immigration.
And remember my opening remarks at Trump Tower when I opened. Everybody said, oh, he was so tough. And I used the word rape. And yesterday it came out where this journey coming up, women are raped at levels that nobody's ever seen before. They don't want to mention that. So we have to change our laws.
And today the president said he may send 2,000 to 4,000 National Guard troops to the border, but other details such as when that might happen, whether they'll be armed, remain murky tonight. Wolf?
Pamela Brown at the White House, thanks very much. Let's get some more now on the breaking news on Stormy Daniels, the president publicly denying he knew about the hush money she received from his lawyer, Michael Cohen. Let's get to our legal analyst, Joey Jackson. Joey, the president says he didn't know about that $130,000 payment to Stormy Daniels. Does that actually invalidate the hush agreement?
You know, Wolf, good evening. It depends who you ask. Now, on the first end of it, you can make the argument, right, that a contract is offer acceptance. And therefore, if I extend an offer to you, Wolf, you accept. You and I are the parties to the contract. To the extent that the president has no knowledge of the contract, where is the acceptance? Who was accepting on his behalf, therefore invalid? Of course, Mr. Avenatti is making a number of other arguments that I think are meritorious in addition to that. However, on the other end of it, you can make the argument that it was a third-party beneficiary contract. You and I have spoken about this. I purchase a car for my son. My son has no knowledge he's getting a car at all. He's not on the contract or otherwise a party. If that car is not delivered to me, however, he has rights to enforce the contract as a third-party beneficiary. And so that's the argument I thought they were making until I heard the president say that Michael Avenatti was acting as my lawyer. I thought the president's team was going in the way of Michael Avenatti, making the argument that was they were saying that this was a familial relationship. And as a result of a familial relationship, it would, of course, refute Mr. Avenatti's arguments in that regard by saying the contract then would still be valid.
Because the president flatly said when he was asked, did Michael Cohen, his longtime attorney, make it the payment? The president said, you have to ask Michael Cohen. Michael Cohen is my attorney. Use the word attorney. Michael Cohen is my attorney. You'll have to ask him. And what you're saying, Joey, is the use of the word attorney is very significant.
I think it's highly significant because then you get into the area of this, first of all, the believability area. Is there anyone out there listening to you and I who really believes that any attorney on the planet would make a commitment like that on behalf of a client for $130,000 out of a home equity loan? I like to think that I represent my clients well. I like to think that I care about them greatly. There will be no time that you will find me taking personal funds and getting those funds on their behalf in order to satisfy a payment. On the other hand, however, if you would talk about me acting as a family member, as a friend, as a longtime confidant, that would change the equation. And to the extent that the president is saying that he was acting as my lawyer, that really goes against the whole third-party beneficiary argument. So I'm concerned about the use of that language, yes.
Michael Cohen's spokesman, David Schwartz, issued a statement following the president's remarks aboard Air Force One. Let me read it to you. This is an accurate assessment of the facts. This is exactly what I have been saying all along. Michael Cohen made the payment to protect reputation, family, and business. It had nothing to do with the election. That's the statement from David Schwartz. But in his comments, the president, again, called Cohen his attorney. And that, as you correctly point out, is a significant word.
I think it's highly significant. And we should also note, I mean, listen, there are two ways, of course, in order to make your case. Obviously, in a court of law, that's the one way. And I think that we'll really learn, should we get to the deposition parts of this, where people have to actually give sworn testimony, we might get to the truth around what happened, how it happened, where the payment come from, how it was made, why it was made. We'll get to that. That's a court of law. But what you read was a statement. And as attorneys, we're also looking to get the high ground in the court of public opinion. But I think from a credibility perspective, if you're going to make the argument that Michael Cohen was simply acting as a lawyer, I just think it defies all common sense and credibility because lawyers do not act in this way. People who love and care about someone, who are family members with someone, who are longtime confidants and advisors with someone, they could, in fact, make a payment. You don't know anything about it. I got you. But to say you acted in my legal capacity, I think that raises the specter of not passing the smell test.
Let me see if you agree with Michael Avenatti and his statement that he released following the president's comments. He said, our case just got that much better, and we very much look forward to testing the truthfulness of Mr. Trump's feigned lack of knowledge concerning the $130,000 payment. As he stated on Air Force One, as history teaches us, it is one thing to deceive the press and quite another to do so under oath. You agree with him that his case just got much better?
Well, let me say this. You know, it's not a lie. It's not a crime to lie to the press, but it certainly is a crime to lie in a deposition or other places. Now, for example, I bring you back 20 years ago when Bill Clinton, then president, looked at the camera and said, I did not have sexual relations with that woman, Monica Lewinsky. I did not. Then Monica Lewinsky testifies in the grand jury. Bill Clinton testifies in the grand jury and says, yes, the relationship was physical. And therefore, he had to tell the truth. And so the problem is now the president is on record. And so in a deposition, it's fair game. Should he depose him, that is Mr. Avenatti, the president, he can ask him the question about what he went on record as saying. And if he veers away from that, it's very dangerous because now you're lying under oath. It gets you into, again, I refer to Bill Clinton, impeachment territory because of a lie you tell in the deposition. I think, and I would be one to advise the president to settle this case immediately. Forget about the motion to compel arbitration. You don't need it. You don't need to be right. Just get out from under it, because if he is deposed, it becomes a significant problem.
And so the point being, how will Michael Avenatti use the president's comments in his case?
I think in a very significant way. I think two ways. Number one, I think he's taking it to the people. He's taking it to the public and speaking about, look, let's talk about this. We as trial lawyers all the time, well, if we go before juries and we talk to them about common sense and good judgment, are there any one of you as you sit there who believe A, B, or C? And the jurors have to answer that question. So in the first way, he's using it to gain the high ground in the court of public opinion, saying this is nonsense. In the second way, I think he'll use it is in the event he gets to depose the president to say, excuse me, Mr. President, you came to the back of Air Force One. You happened to make some statements in response to some questions, did you not? Let's talk about what you said, and let's talk about whether that's true. You know you're under oath, sir, do you not? So answer the following question, and then he'll proceed with asking him questions concerning his relationship with Michael Cohen, the payment of Michael Cohen, was it reimbursed, where did it come from, what was his knowledge of it, what did he know, when did he know it, how did he know it, and that's when you get into ground that you just don't want to be in. You're the president, you got a lot of things to do, know you want to be right, know you're arguing this never happened, write a check. Well, we know Mr. Avenatti said he's not accepting a check. Do what you need to do to get out from under this before you have to testify. And when you testify, you're in very dangerous ground because we know, we could be fair about this, that this president plays fast and loose with what we believe to be truthful. And you can do that in the press. You can do it in the back of Air Force One. You cannot do it in a grand jury. You can't do it in a deposition. You can't do it to federal investigators. You just can't. And so I would say, if I'm advising him, Mr. President, let's take a pass. We need to move on. Settle this case.
Let's say the president is telling the truth, and I'm looking at the transcript of what he said. He did not know about the $130,000 payment to Stormy Daniels. He didn't know why Michael Cohen made the payment. You have to ask Michael Cohen. He didn't know where Michael Cohen got the money. No, I don't know. Let's say he's telling the truth in all of that. What ethical or legal questions potentially would that raise for his attorney, Michael Cohen?
Well, two things, Wolf, and I'll answer that question. But I think in saying that someone is telling the truth, again, it's all about credibility and everything has to be evaluated in context. And I think this is what you hear a lot about. So you mean to tell me 11 days, a week and a half, whatever the specific time frame before an election when you were under siege by women accusing you of various things, and this could have been the straw that broke the camel's back, you knew nothing about it. So it gets to the point of credibility, right? We all as people, you know, law is a gray area. It's never a mathematical science or question. You're operating in the gray and you're relying upon people, jurors, to get it right based upon argument. So to your question, Wolf, is there anyone out there, support the president, not support the president, who believes that that could be true? Now, accepting your proposition that it is for now, now you have to ask about Michael Cohen, which you have. And that is that there are some serious ethical dilemmas. We as lawyers don't go out and settle cases on a whim because we feel like it, because we're good people, because I just want to look out for you. It's the right thing to do. I love you, man. And therefore, we write checks. Not how it works. We have ethical professional rules that we have to deal with, one of which is informed consent. If there's a settlement agreement, I have to speak to my client. We sit down, we talk about it. My client asks, is it a great thing to do? Is it a bad thing to do? How's it going to affect me, my reputation, my family, my job? We have these discussions. You're ethically bound to do that. And to the extent that you don't, it's a problem. And so, yes, it would affect him, and it would appear to me that the president, by calling him my lawyer, could have very, very easily said, you know, he's like family to me. I love him. He's like a son to me. Would have changed the equation. He said my lawyer. And if the president is telling the truth in that regard, I think it raises some questions for Mr. Cohen.
You believe it could change the request by Stormy Daniels attorney Michael Avenatti to depose President Trump?
I'm one that believes, I mean, look, I've seen the various press that he's done, you know, on this and other networks concerning this particular case. He appears to me to be driven by the truth. This doesn't appear to be a money-based type of approach to litigation. I think he's made plenty of that. And so the reality then becomes is if you want to get to the truth, the best way you get to it is by having people, Wolf, raise that hand. And you have a court reporter there and everything is transcribed. And goodness forbid, you veer away from what's truthful. And again, you know, we know the president is, he's very apt to sort of, we can call it puffing, we could call it misrepresentations, we could call it fabrications, but there are some concerns about things that he says that are not true. You can't do that in a deposition. He could talk to you and do it, he could go on other networks and do it, he could come to the back of the plane and Air Force One and do it. When you're under oath, you gotta tell the truth. And if you don't, guess what? Bill Clinton, again, hate to speak about him, but the fact is that he was impeached as a result of a lie he told in a deposition. You don't want this happening to you, Mr. President. Settle this case. Get out from under it, whatever it takes.
Joey, Peter Stris, he's the attorney for Karen McDougal, the former playmate who also alleged having an affair with Donald Trump. Stris just wrote this on Twitter, quote, now that real Donald Trump has cleared up everything for Michael Avenatti, Ree Stormy Daniels, will he be making a statement about our client, Karen McDougal, or should we ask Michael Cohen? What's your reaction to that?
My reaction to that is that obviously it's gamesmanship. I think it's a, you know, wise tweet to make in this point in time. I would advise the president not to be making any statements at all, whether it relates to Ms. McDougal, Ms. Zervos, as it relates to Stormy Daniels, why he said this, why he came to the back of the plane, why he ad-libbed it. I have no idea. First thing we say to clients, well, please don't stalk. Don't say anything. He did say something. He's on record now. And I would highly doubt he would say something about Ms. McDougal.